I've had the privilege this week to co-host, along with my colleagues here, Dr. Gwyneira Isaac from the National Museum of Natural History, the privilege to host a very strong roster of scholars and Native community leaders dedicated to a present and future of health and wellness for Native peoples. These are all individuals in the front line of a large and compelling challenge to assist our communities in achieving a good balance, a good state of being, good, healthy lives. Gwyneira?
Thank you, José. I'm very honored to be here today. And we welcome into our planning group Katsi Cook, who has been really instrumental and a central player in this building of this, both the team that is represented here today and the network that we hope to build that's dealing with health issues. So this is the culmination of a three-day workshop where Gaji's been instrumental in bringing together people from the communities, giving their experiences, people from anthropology, American Indian studies, museums, medical anthropology, and so forth, bringing everyone together so that we can synthesize in a much more effective way. And these networks really come from Gaji. So I want to thank her for sharing these wonderful people with us. Thank you. So let me introduce to you. It's important to acknowledge her role as a Mohawk midwife and a health activist. So thank you. Let me introduce you to Katsi.
Thank you, Gwen and José. Within the walls of this Smithsonian institution, stored in bins and behind glass cases, are the seeds and bits of sacred things that this generation is bringing back, illuminating with the light of practice. Culture and health is all in the practice. And so it's my privilege to present to you this morning key practitioners of culture of the Haudenosaunee people, where we hold the belief that the woman is the first environment, the doorway from the sky world into this life. And so to begin our day together, I introduce to you Beverly Cook, who's an elected chief of the St. Regis Mohawk Tribal Council, straddling the U.S.-Canadian border in northern New York State. The Mohawk community of Akwesasne is one of 564 federally recognized tribes, home to 13,000 Mohawk people. Beverly is a family nurse practitioner and sexual assault nurse examiner. She served as clinic coordinator at the St. Regis Mohawk Health Services, where she led an innovative tribal health care facility and systems redesign from acute medical care to trauma-informed prevention and wellness. In 2010, she directed the implementation of centering pregnancy at St. Regis Mohawk Health Services. Centering is an empowerment model of group prenatal care that brings community members together for health assessment, learning, and support. Under her direct leadership, the St. Regis Mohawk Health Services became the first tribally run official centering site in the United States in December 2011. In 2012, the program received a local impact award from the National Indian Health Board. Until Beverly's election to the Tribal Council in 2013, women, as a result of women lining up their agreements, Beverly was a participating member of the St. Regis Mohawk Tribe's Healing to Wellness Drug Court and the multidisciplinary team at the Partridge House, the only tribally run chemical dependency inpatient treatment facility east of the Mississippi. She was a Robert Wood Johnson Foundation Community Health Leader nominee in 2011. Beverly is active in traditional indigenous practices in her community. She lives on the Haudenosaunee-Mohawk territory along the beautiful St. Lawrence River with her husband, Steve, and has three daughters and a son, and is the proud grandmother of three. I give to you Beverly Cook.
Good afternoon, and thank you. And my daughter will be proud to see that I made it all the way up here without falling down. It's an inside joke. I thank you, Gaji, for that beautiful introduction. And I just want to get my timer set here so I don't go over, because I have lots to talk to you about. I'm happy to see young people here. I was nervous until I saw that, because you are where my heart lies and my hope lies. I elected to put up this picture. It's a painting by John Sawathise Thomas. He, in Haudenosaunee, is a culture bearer. He is the kind of man that the rest of us measure ourselves against. And I decided, instead of using slides, to keep this image up behind me for my sake and for your sake. Some of the information that I'm going to talk about is hard to hear. It's hard to think about. And I want to let you know now that if there's any time that you feel uncomfortable or you feel anxious, that it's okay to reach out to somebody. It's okay to leave and get a breath of fresh air if you need to. I know how it can make you feel. It's an emotional topic for myself as well. So now that I got you all scared. The place that I come from, Haudenosaunee, is a Mohawk reservation that straddles the U.S.-Canadian border in northern New York. And that wasn't by choice. That was an implementation of government policy by the U.S. and Canadian government that has made the lives of the people in Haudenosaunee difficult ever since. Many of the things that the United States and Canadian government does is not by accident, it's by design. So I was asked today to speak about Native health and tribal well-being. And in order to do that, I'm going to have to go back in the past a little bit. And the reason is because what our history has been for us is part of the reason that we are in the state of somewhat poor health, and how we have a difficult time with our own feelings of well-being. Native people are diverse, as Gaji said. There's over 500 different tribes with different languages, different ceremonies, different traditions, different customs, different types of government. Some nations, like myself, like Haudenosaunee, have even different types of government within our community. But we all share the same trauma of government policies created to deal with the Indian problem. Many of us have been displaced. We've lost vast areas of land and continue to suffer the effects of the boarding school policy designed to kill the Indian but save the man. Many of us suffer the effects of industrial contamination of our land, water, and air that you'll hear about later on this afternoon. And because of all that I mentioned and more, I think the health issues of Native communities are much broader and deeper than what we currently or are willing to address in the conventional healthcare settings, using conventional healthcare methods during conventional hours of operation. Meaning, yes, we have hypertension, yes, we have diabetes, yes, we have heart disease, and we have critical issues with obesity, but we also have the highest rates of sexual assault against our women, the highest rates of suicide among our youth, the highest rates of death from liver disease and alcoholism, and the highest rates from accidental death. That means tragedy. I don't consider these issues conventional whatsoever. We have increasing numbers of people coming forward with issues rooted in trauma, seeing physical symptoms that are the manifestations of concealed childhood trauma is becoming more and more common. Violent relationships, stress reactions from sexual abuse, disrupted family bonds secondary to addiction, poor access to good food, economic struggles, and increasing incarcerations. This is not what I consider healthy. Currently, no treatment protocols exist for those kinds of health issues inside of most medical clinics. The question when they see our patients come forward with these kinds of issues is, where's the pills? And what kind of pills and how many pills can we throw at this person who's having symptoms of PTSD, anxiety reactions, and panic disorders? There is no surgery that's going to fix it, and oftentimes healthcare providers are uncomfortable with it and refuse to look at it and instead chastise the patient for not being able to lose weight, not being able to take their medicine on time, not being able to get their blood sugars down the way that we ordered them to. Currently, no treatment protocols exist for those kinds of health issues inside of most medical clinics. These are the roots of trauma-informed approaches. These are the conditions that created the atmosphere, the situation, the circumstances that required trauma-informed approaches. Trauma-informed approaches means that you recognize the trauma, you appreciate the trauma reactions, you appreciate the symptoms, and then you set about doing something about it. You don't just throw your hands up and say, oh, well, maybe we need to give them a mental health referral. And if you get a mental health referral, they need to navigate whatever systems that means for them to get the kind of care that they need. And if they're lucky, they'll get real care and they won't just simply get medicine or pills thrown at them. The concept of trauma-informed approaches in healthcare and organizations is gaining momentum in pockets of the country, including in Indian country. The increasing recognition of our shared historical trauma would cause you to think, or caused me to think, that isn't trauma-informed approaches the next logical step? You would think that perhaps maybe Indian Health Service, being a health service designated to deliver health care to Native people, understanding our collective history of trauma would make it mandatory to have trauma-informed approaches within every single clinic across the country. That said, a broad trauma-informed approach is something we must and should come up with for ourselves, whether it's within our clinics, whether it's in our governmental systems, or whether it's within the community itself. The people must demand culturally safe spaces and providers of any service that we come across. We deserve it. To me, cultural safety is recognizing we all share a history of trauma, and because I recognize that, I will treat you with compassion, and I will respect your beliefs, even if they are different from mine. As providers and leaders, we have to take a good look at the people and really see them, really look at them, really listen to them, really hear what it is that they're saying, and give them what they need. Not what makes us comfortable, not what keeps us in our comfort zone, but respond to what it is that they're looking for. We have to stop saying that, well, that's all I have. I can't do anything more for you. I'll have to refer you, or I don't know, and turn around and declare that they've been a bad patient because they didn't respond or they failed therapy, which puts all of the responsibility on the person. We need to create safe spaces for this kind of care. They might be protected spaces, perhaps sacred spaces, or in the back room of a police station. It's not the Native wall art on the wall that makes the difference. It's the facilitator, it's the physician, it's the provider, it's the nurse, it's the counselor. Even within the sacred spaces of sweat lodges, there needs to be a sensitivity to what people carry with them. An experienced practitioner of those sacred ways can make that space available. And I think that that sacred space can be made anywhere you're sitting with someone if you just afford them the time and the attention. If we can accept this, we can begin to create those spaces wherever they're needed, whether it's in clinics or in tribal offices. This holistic concept is not foreign in the medical community. It's not like they don't do it for other people. For instance, a woman who has had a mastectomy, a breast removed because of breast cancer, every effort is made to reconstruct her breast so that she feels whole, so that her self-esteem is intact, so that she can go on and conduct her life in as normal a manner as possible. If someone has to have a limb amputated, every effort is made to replace that with a prosthetic limb so that the person can feel whole, so that the person can get up and walk around and be productive and go on with his life. When someone has coronary bypass surgery, they go to cardiac rehab, they get counseling, and it's well known in the medical field that especially men who have had bypass surgery get very depressed after, because they have to face their vulnerability, because it's a blow to their self-esteem. So the point I'm getting at is that even in the medical community, someone with a physical problem, with a physical ailment that hurts and harms their spirit, is not left laying on the ground with missing parts, left to have to put themselves back together again. Every effort is made to make them whole again. And my question is, why, when people suffer trauma with big holes in their spirit, there isn't an extended effort to put them back together again, to face what it is that put them in that position in the first place? So in the case of trauma, we're beginning to realize as a whole that it's not enough to simply acknowledge it. So I've read and heard about historical trauma, generational trauma now for several days, and I still want to get at the meat of it, and I'm going to take that opportunity here. When we talk about any kind of trauma, I think the mystery is for providers and for practitioners is, how do we get there? How do we ask those questions? And I have a questionnaire that I'll give you after I'm done speaking. It was developed by Dr. Vincent Folletti. Has anybody heard about the ACE study? Few people, that's great. Dr. Folletti was running an obesity clinic in the Kaiser Permanente HMO in California. While he was working in the obesity clinic, he discovered that getting people to lose a lot of weight was really easy. The difficult part was getting them to keep the weight off. Inadvertently, he discovered that many of his obese patients had something in common, and that common thread was a history of child sexual abuse. And he came upon it accidentally. It wasn't anything that had ever occurred to him. And he says, when he speaks about it, that when he discovered this one particular patient had regained 35 pounds of her, all the weight that she had lost, and had regained it in a week, he thought it was impossible. And so he spoke to her, he asked her questions, and he asked her, because the subject had come up about sex, he said, well, how much did you weigh when you had your first sexual encounter? And she said, 45 pounds. And he said, no, I mean when you had your first sexual encounter. And she said, I was 45 pounds, I was like 5 years old. And so he said, "Oh my God, this is remarkable." And a couple weeks later, he ran across another one of his patients who disclosed a similar experience in their childhood, and he thought, "I'll be darned, two cases of sexual abuse in 23 years of practice. I wonder what's going on." And in his what must have been a sheltered life, he realized that this problem was way bigger than what he had ever imagined. He continued to do work on in that regard. He went from symposium to symposium speaking about adverse childhood experiences, which is what ACE stands for. He spoke about adverse childhood experiences, and finally, after 10 years, he ran into another physician, Dr. Robert Anda from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, who was also coming across similar revelations in his practice. Together, they started a study, and between 1985 and 1995, I'm sorry, it was 10 years later, in 1997, 98, they went to the Kaiser Permanente Clinic, and they asked people as they came in the door, "Would you like to participate in a study about adverse childhood experiences?" And some people said yes. They got 17,334 patients to agree to be in the study, and they're still in the study today. They asked them 10 questions, and they did it in a way that was not too shocking. I'm going to give you the 10 questions after I'm finished. But he embedded the questions inside of a medical survey, one similar to the one that you get when you go to a specialist and they send you a packet and they want to know how much you smoke, how many operations you had, what your father passed away from, and so on. And inside of those questions, they asked about childhood experiences. They tailored them around neglect, physical neglect, emotional neglect, and also abuses, and also family dysfunction. And what they discovered from the results of studying 17,334 patients was that ACEs are very common but largely unrecognized. We all know about them, but we don't talk about them. That ACEs are strong predictors of later social functioning, well-being, health risks, disease, medical costs, and death. ACEs are the basis for much of adult medicine and many major public health and social problems, and ACEs are interrelated. They're not solitary. ACEs are the leading determinant of the health and social well-being of our nation, regardless of race or ethnicity. The people that were, the 17,000 people consisted, 70% of them were Caucasian, most of them went to college, 10% were Latino, and 10% were Black. They all had some college, they all had jobs. So it wasn't disenfranchised populations. So they asked questions, very personal questions, about whether you felt that a parent or adult in the household had mental illness, whether a member of your household had been incarcerated, if you'd ever seen your father hit your mother, were your parents ever separated or divorced, did anybody in your family have problems with addiction, alcoholism, and so on, had you ever been hit, had you ever been sexually abused, and so on. So every time you answer yes to one of those questions, was anybody in your family alcoholic? Yes. Did your parents ever get separated or divorced? Yes. Were you ever hit so that it left marks on your body? Yes. Did anybody in your family ever go to jail? Yes, that's four right there. And many people experience more ACEs than that. So an ACE score of four or more ended up with these results. If you have an A score of 4 or more, you're twice as likely to be a smoker. If you have 4 or more ACEs, you're 7 times more likely to be an alcoholic. If you have 4 or more ACEs, you are 12 times more likely to have attempted suicide. And if you have 4 or more ACEs, you're 10 times more likely to have injected street drugs. It was, when I heard those results, it validated everything that I had seen and all of the work that I had been doing in my community. It's something that we all know, but we don't talk about it and we don't say the words, and we sure don't talk to our patients about it. The identification of the problem starts with 10 questions. And how you ask it otherwise, if you don't have this in front of you and you have someone that comes to you, or even if it's a friend who seems like something's really wrong, if it's a child that's acting up and is displaying behavior that you don't understand, the question is, what happened? What happened to you? What happened? Not, what's wrong with you? Or what's wrong with you? Or when they come into a doctor's office, not what's wrong, what can I do for you today? It's what happened. Many providers are afraid to ask that question. They feel that if they do and they go here and they say these words, that their patient is going to fall down on the floor, start crying, and they're not going to be able to get them out. They're going to have to spend more than the 15 minutes, if they're lucky, that is allotted to their appointment, and it's gonna be a travesty. And actually, most of the time when I've asked those questions, it's been a relief, and they've been perfectly honest. And then I say, okay, I want to talk about this more. Are you okay? And if they say yes, then I said, let's make an appointment just to talk about this. And they come back. And it's a relief that they finally were able to let that go. So the ACE study is one way of helping Indian people, your neighbors, your parents, anybody that's around you that's having a difficult time. One of my solutions, what I think should happen is that ACE study, that kind of consciousness and awareness about the people you're dealing with and those questions and that kind of an attitude should be in all of our clinics. It should be in every doctor's office. It should be in every school. And it should be in every mental health setting. It may sound drastic, but actually in Vermont, a Vermont state legislator and physician, Dr. George Till, recently introduced a bill into his state because he heard Dr. Folletti speak. And it's the first bill in any state in the nation that calls for the integration of the science of adverse childhood experiences into medical and health school curricula and continuing education, meaning doctors should learn it, nurses should learn it, everyone, social workers should learn it. It should be standard in everything that you do. In addition, Washington State passed a law in 2011 to identify and promote new strategies and develop a public-private partnership to support effective strategies. The initiative is currently evaluating 5 communities, and they have incorporated ACEs into their school systems, and their school systems are becoming trauma-informed, which means to realize and to acknowledge that some kids can't sit in a seat and learn, because they don't know if there's going to be supper on the table when they get there. They don't know if their mother's going to be home or where their father is, or if there's going to be a big fight. And to expect kids to learn under those conditions is unfair. So I beseech you all to look at one another with kindness, to extend that unconditional personal regard to each other, no matter what the station in life is of the person that you're dealing with. And in Native communities, especially, those solutions, those reactions to ourselves are going to come from the ground. They're going to come up out of the dirt. And you're going to hear the next speaker, Louise, is going to come back and talk about Ohologo, which is a rites of passage program that was developed out of pure need, no funding. She's the program. There is no sponsoring agency. It's everybody pitches in. And she's become a community institution at Haudenosaunee. I had a ton more things I wanted to talk about, but I'm out of time. So I appreciate you listening, and I will make these ACE study questions available to you, and I would look at them with someone just to bounce it off. You don't have to go deep, but I think if you can think with each other ways that you can use it, you might see yourself in those questions, or you might see your neighbor, you may see your brother, and I hope it helps. I hope it helps you somehow. So our tribal well-being, we have challenges. And my challenge, one of my biggest challenges, is to get people to go there. We've gotten to the generational trauma part. Now we need to go into what does that really look like and what does that really mean. So thank you very much for your attention.